Good morning students. In the previous video, we discussed operating system introduction, kernel specification, real-time operating system, real-time kernel functions, hardware and software real-time, task, process and threads. Let's talk about the next topic today, multiprocessing and multitasking. The terms multiprocessing and multitasking are somewhat confusing and sound very similar. In the context of an operating system, multiprocessing refers to the ability to run multiple processes at the same time. Multiprocessor system are systems that can perform multiple tasks at the same time. Multiprocessor systems have multiple CPUs and can run multiple processes at the same time. So, multi-programming refers to the ability of the operating system to have multiple programs in memory that are ready for execution. Multiple process cannot be executed concurrently in a uniprocessor system. Multitasking refers to an operating system ability to keep several processes in memory and move to the CPU from one process to another. Multitasking produces the illusion of the multiple tasks running concurrently. The moving of the CPU from one task to another is referred to as multitasking. When task or process, when task or process switching occurs in a multitasking environment, the properties of the virtual processor are translated to those of the physical processor. The operating system kernel scheduler controls the transition from virtual to physical processor. Context switching refers to the act of switching the CPU between processor or modify the current execution context. Context saving is the act of saving the current context, which includes the context information for the currently running operation at the time of a CPU switching. So, context retrieval is the method of restoring the saved context information for a process that will be performed due to the CPU switching. Context switching, context saving and context retrieval are all aspects of a multitasking. So, this diagram shows the context switching diagram. The next slide shows the different types of multitasking. The switching of execution between different tasks is referred to as multitasking. Multitasking can be divided into many categories based on how the switching act is carried out. That is to say, cooperative multitasking, preemptive multitasking and non-preemptive multitasking. The next slide shows the task scheduling. So, multitasking involves switching between tasks during execution. There should be some process in place to distribute the CPU among the various tasks and to determine which task should be performed at any given time. Job scheduling or process scheduling is the process of determining which task or process will be carried out at a specified point in time. The basis of multitasking is task scheduling. Scheduling policies serve as an instruction for deciding which task are to be completed. The scheduling policies are implemented in an algorithm that is run as a service by the kernel. The kernel service that implements the scheduling algorithm is known as a scheduler. The process scheduling decision can be made when a process changes a state to ready state from running state, then blocked or a wait state from running state, then ready state from blocked or wait state, then completed state. When choosing a scheduling criterion, an algorithm keep the following factors in mind. The first one is a CPU utilization, turnaround time, waiting time, response time. Okay, so these points are considered. The next slide shows the operating system, that is a illustration of processor transition through various queues. The operating system keeps the different queues in a connection with the CPU scheduling, and a process passes through these queues some admittance to execution completion. The various queues maintained by the operating system in conjunction with the CPU scheduling are as follows. The first one is a job queue, second one ready queue, and third one is a device queue. So during its path from admitted to completed, a process moves through all of these queues. The diagram shows the processor progression through the different queues. Scheduling can be divided into the following groups based on the scheduling algorithm used. The first one is a preemptive scheduling, second one non-preemptive scheduling. Let's see the first one, that is a preemptive scheduling. Preemptive scheduling is used in system that use the preemptive multitasking model. So every task in the ready queue gets a chance to execute the preemptive scheduling. The type of a preemptive scheduling algorithm used to schedule the process determine when and how often each process executes. The scheduler will preempt the currently running task or process and select another task from the ready queue for execution in this type of scheduling. The scheduling algorithm determines when to preempt a task and which task is to be picked up from the ready queue for execution after preempting the current task. When a task is preempted by scheduling, it is shifted to the ready queue. Preemption is the act of the scheduler pushing a running process into the ready queue without the processing requesting it. Preemptive scheduling can be applied in variety of ways. Time-based preemption and priority-based preemption are the two main approach used in preemptive scheduling. The following section describes the different forms of preemptive scheduling used in the task or process scheduling. The first one, that is a preemptive shortest job first scheduling or shortest remaining time, and that is the SJF or SRT scheduling. When a new process enters the ready queue, the preemptive SJF scheduling algorithm sorts the ready queue and tests whether the execution time of the new process is shorter than the remaining time of the cumulative expected time for the currently executing process. Okay, that is called as a shortest job first scheduling. So if the new process execution time is less than the current process execution time, the current process is preempted and the new process is scheduled for execution. As a result, a preemptive SJF scheduling compares the execution completion time at all times. Shortest remaining time scheduling is another term for a preemptive SJF scheduling. The next slide shows the round robin scheduling algorithm. So here the word round robin is very common in the sports and games world. The term round robin or knockout league refers to any football or cricket competition. In the round robin league, each team in a group has an equal opportunity to play against the other teams in the same group. While in the knockout league, the losing team in a match is eliminated from the competition. So round robin conveys the same idea of a fair opportunity to everyone in the sense of pace scheduling. Each process in the ready queue is executed for a predefined time slot in round robin scheduling. The execution begins by selecting the first process in the ready queue. Then it is executed for a predetermined amount of time. Then that amount of time expires after the procedure is completed. The next process in the ready queue is selected for execution. This is done for each process in the ready queue. After each process in the ready queue has been executed for the predefined time period, the scheduler returns and select the first process in the ready queue for execution once more. So the process is repeated. The time slice is given by the timer ticker function of the operating system kernel's time management unit. The time slice is kernel based and ranges from a few microseconds to milliseconds. Certain operating system kernels can make the time slice user configurable. So round robin scheduling ensures that each process receives a set of amount of CPU time to execute. The first come first served FCFS scheme determines when the model or method receives its set time for execution. If a process terminates before the time slice expires, the CPU is released voluntarily and the next process in the queue is scheduled for execution by the scheduler. Then kernel is needed for the implementation of a round robin scheduling. Round robin scheduling entails a significant amount of overhead in preserving time slice information for and procedure that is currently being performed. Then next one is a priority based scheduling. At a high priority process that enters the ready queue in that ready queue is immediately scheduled for execution in preemptive scheduling, while in non-preemptive scheduling any high priority process that enters the ready queue is scheduled only after the currently executing process finishes its execution. In preemptive scheduling, the priority of a task or procedure is stated in the same way as it is in the mechanism used for non-preemptive multitasking. Except for the switching of execution between tasks, the priority based preemptive scheduling algorithm is the same way as the non-preemptive priority based scheduling algorithm. In non-preemptive scheduling system that uses the multitasking, that is a non-preemptive multitasking model is used, the currently executing task or process is allowed to run until it terminates or enters the wait state while waiting for an IO or system resource in this scheduling form. So the following are the different types of non-preemptive scheduling used in task or process scheduling, that is a first come first served or first in first out scheduling. The first come first served scheduling algorithm assigns CPU time to process depending on the order in which they join the ready queue. The first phase entered is serviced first. It is the same as every other real world program that employs queue system. Example, a ticketing reservation system in which people must stand in line and the first person in line is served. Then first come first served scheduling is also known as first in first out, since the process that is placed first in the ready queue is serviced first. Then next one, that is a last come first in, that is a last come first service or last in first out scheduling algorithm. The last come first in served scheduling algorithm also assigns CPU time to processors in the order they are asked to ready queue. The most recently entered process is the served first. That is a last in first out scheduling is another name for LCFS, last come first in first service scheduling, in which the method that is placed last in the ready queue is served first. Then third method called as shortest job first, that is SJF scheduling. When a process abundant of a CPU, the SJF scheduling algorithm sorts the ready queue to select the process with the shortest expected completion or runtime. In SJF The process with the shortest expected run time is scheduled first, followed by the next shortest process and so on. Then fourth method, that is a priority based scheduling. In non-preemptive scheduling, the turnaround time, that is a TAT, and waiting time for a process vary depending on the scheduling algorithm. As opposed to the other low priority process in the ready queue, the priority based non-preemptive scheduling algorithm ensures that the process with the high priority are serviced first. So various methods may be used to signify the importance of a task to or procedure. SJF algorithm can be thought of as a priority based scheduling algorithm, with each task given priority in the order of time needs to complete it. The shorter the time it takes to complete a procedure, the higher its priority in the SJF algorithm. The priority is a number ranging from 0 to the highest priority provided by the operating system. The maximum degree of priority is determined by the operating system. The non-preemptive priority based scheduled, that is a non-preemptive priority based scheduler, sorts the ready queue by priority and execute the procedure with the highest level of priority. Then the next slide shows the task communication. So there are two types of task communication. One is a cooperative process, another one competing process. Actually, multiple tasks or processes run simultaneously in a multitasking system. So each process may or may not communicate with the other. So the process that operate on the operating system, that will be categorized based on the level of interaction. Let's say the first one, that is a cooperating process, to complete its execution in the cooperating interaction model, one process needs a feedback from other process. The following approach are used by cooperating system to share information and communicate. Okay, let's see the first one, that is a cooperation through sharing. So data is exchanged between the cooperating process through some shared resources. That type is called as a cooperation through sharing. Then second method, that is a cooperation through communication. Here no data is exchanged between processes, but they communicate for synchronization. So this is a second method. Okay, then second type, that is a task communication, second type is a competing process. In competing process, share nothing, but they do share system resources. The competing process complete the system resources such as a file, a display device and so on. Inter-process or task communication is the mechanism by which process or task communicate with one another. Inter-process communication, that is IPC, is a critical for process coordination. The various types of IPC mechanism used by the process are kernel dependent. Some of the key IPC mechanism used by various kernels are described below. That is the first one, shared memory. Okay, see the concept of a shared memory. So process share something, share memory space in order to interact with one another. The process writes information to the shared memory region that will be transmitted by the process. Other processes that need this data will read it from the shared memory region. It is similar to real world. So real world example, where a notice board is used by a company to distribute a public information to its workers. The kernel determines how the shared memory principle is implemented. So different kernels use a different mechanism to accomplish this. The next one shows the concept of pipe for IPC. Pipes is a part of a shared memory that processes use to communicate with one another. pipes complies to the client server model. Pipe server is a process that generate a pipe. Then a pipe client is a process that that connect to a pipe. Okay, so a pipe is a medium for information flow that has two logical end. It can be unidirectional. Unidirectional means allowing information to flow in one direction, or bidirectional. Bidirectional means allowing information to flow in both direction. Unidirectional pipe allows the process connected at one end to right to the pipe, and the process connected at the other end to read the data, while the bidirectional pipe allows the both the reading and writing at one end. Okay, then pipe implementation. Pipe implementation is also operating system based for IPC, Microsoft Windows desktop operating system support two types of pipes. They are anonymous pipes and named pipes. So anonymous pipes are unnamed unidirectional pipes used for data transfer between two processes. Whereas named pipes is a named unidirectional or bidirectional pipe used for data exchange between process. The mechanism that produces the named pipe like anonymous pipe is known as a pipe server. A pipe client is a mechanism that connect the named pipe. With the named pipe, any process can function as both a client or a server, allowing for point-to-point communication. Then the next slide shows the memory mapped object. That is a concept of a memory mapped object. Memory mapped object are a shared memory techniques used by some RTOs to allocate a shared block of memory that can be evaluated by multiple processes at the same time. A mapping object is generated in this method, and a physical storage for it is reserved and committed. A process can map the entire dedicated physical area or a portion of it to its virtual address space. A process read and write operation to do this virtual address space are guided to its dedicated physical area. So any process that want to share data with the other process can map the mapped object physical memory area to its virtual memory space and use it for data sharing. Then the next one, concept of a message queue based in indirect messaging for IPC. So before moving to this topic, let's see first one, that is a message passing. So message passing is a synchronous or asynchronous information sharing mechanism that is used in IPC or thread communication. The primary difference between shared memory and message passing is that shared memory can transfer a large amount of data, while the message passing can only transmit a small amount of data. Message forwarding is therefore faster and free of synchronization overhead as opposed to shared memory. Based on the message passing operation between the process, message passing is classified into message queue, mailbox and signaling. So this is the message queue diagram. Typically the process that wants to communicate with another process send a message to a FIFO queue named a message queue, which temporarily stores the message in a system specified memory object before passing them to the desired process. Send and receive approaches are used to send and receive messages. Messages are exchanged via a message queue, and the send and receive methods are based on the operating system kernel. The kernel of the Windows XP operating system keeps a single system message queue and one thread specific message queue. When one thread needs to connect with another, it sends a message to the device message queue. The kernel retrieves a message from the device message queue one at a time checks them to determine the destination thread, then post the message to the message queue of the corresponding thread. Depending on the action of the memory posting thread, the message process is categorized as synchronous and asynchronous. The message posting thread in asynchronous messaging simply posts the message to the queue and does not wait for an acknowledgement from the thread to which the message is posted. While in synchronous messaging, the message posting the thread enters a waiting state, then wait for that message result from the thread to which the message is posted. Then the next diagram shows the mailbox based on indirect messaging for IPC. So mailbox is an alternative form for message queue, and it is used for IPC in some RTOs. The mailbox IPC technique in RTOs is usually used for one-way messaging. The task or a thread that wishes to send a message to other task or thread produces a mailbox in which the message are posted. Threads that wants to receive message posted to the mailbox by the mailbox creator thread will subscribe to it. The thread that creates the mailbox is referred to as the mailbox server, and the thread that subscribe to it are referred to as the mailbox client. The mailbox server send the message to the mailbox and notify the client who have subscribed to it. When the client received the email, they read the message from the mailbox. Mailbox development, subscription, message reading and writing are all accomplished using operating system kernel API calls. The functionality of a mailbox and a message queue is the same. The only difference between them is the number of messages they will support. Both are used to transfer data in the form of messages from one job to another, one task to another. Mailboxes are used to exchange a single message between two tasks or between an ISR and a task. The implementation of a mailbox is based on the operating system kernel. And third way, that is a signaling. Signaling is a simple method of communicating between process or threads. Signals are used for asynchronous alert in which one process or thread fires a signal to indicate the occurrence of a scenario for which other processes or thread are waiting. Signals are not queued and do not transport data. Signaling is demonstrated by the communication mechanism used in the RTX 51 Tiny operating system. Then the operating system sends signal kernel call under RTX 51, send a signal from one task is to specified a task. Likewise, the operating system wait kernel call wait for a given signal. Signals for inter-process communication are also implemented in the VxWorks RTOs kernel. When a specific signal happens, it is controlled by a signal handler. Then, so far we have covered multitasking, multiprocessing, types of multitasking, task scheduling types, and task communication types. The remaining topics will be covered in the next video. Thank you.